When I was in remission from stage 2 cancer, I had a friend who was dying and things were not looking good. So I contacted a few resources and said, I have a friend who's leaning on me. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. And she contacted me and she said, a big part of what people deal with at their end of life is legacy. And I thought, oh, that's something I had never considered before. And so my friend did pass away and I felt like I wasn't able to help in any way with her legacy. So my husband's cousins, their dad ended up with brain cancer and he did not have long to live. So I thought, I'm gonna take this piece of legacy and contact them. So I contacted them and I said, I hope I'm not overstepping here, but this is what I know about legacy. And so they were able to plant a tree in his name that they can now visit now that he's passed away and they can feel very close to him. And so when I was diagnosed, very quickly I knew that, okay, I'm 31. I thought I had hopefully 3 times as long of my life to create this legacy, and I don't. Now I have a few years. So what am I gonna do? And I thought, I have to single-handedly fund a hospital for sick children and save the whole world, and people have to know my name. I have to be in textbooks. I put all this pressure on myself. And that pressure lasted a long time, like at least a year of, oh, I've gotta do something big. I have to write a book. I have to share my experiences. I just had all this crazy pressure on top of dealing with stage 4 cancer. So then I kind of started to learn that it's about the legacy that we all have. We're all living our legacies right now. And I didn't realize that piece. And I didn't realize that whether we like it or not, our legacy will live after us regardless of if we're intending to leave our mark. And so that took a little bit of pressure off. It's like, okay, I've been planning a legacy all this time. Maybe it just wasn't intended. And that has helped with some of my intended legacy and some of my advocacy work that I've done and some of the connections I have made. And then the tangible and intangible aspect of it too is that what can people go and physically touch or see or look up online that they can feel connected with me and see things that I've done, or that feeling, that way that you make somebody laugh endlessly, and you can't take that away. You can't remove that feeling. And so I've just learned that the definition of legacy is just so much broader than I thought, which took some of the pressure off to do something absolutely massive, that a building that houses the Mona Lisa and, you know, all these things that I thought that I had to do for people to remember me. And then I thought, no, they're going to remember the way you feel. But at the same time, I do like the tangible aspect of legacy, but I've just brought it down to a smaller scale. And so my brother is planning an annual motorcycle ride called Katie's Ride every year. We're hoping to maybe do some bursaries for our local high school. So different aspects of that are important to me, but it's also the relationships that I've made and the people. I think about my funeral and the stories that'll be said, and I've lived an amazing life so far and hope that I do have another 30 years, but realistically, knowing that I probably won't, the stories that will be shared and what maybe kids who are 4 and 5 will still hear about 20 years later and the hilarity that has just ensued in so many situations. So I think the important part is learning that legacy doesn't have to be this overarching, massive donation or building in order to have one. Everybody has a legacy.